Jesus' name we pray. Heavenly Father, I present these your children before you. As many as are down, lift them up. As many as are sick, heal them. As many as are oppressed, deliver them. As many as are failing, lead them up to the mountaintop of success in Jesus' name. Grant every heart desire. Fulfill every aspiration. Grant every petition. And confirm the blessing of your people upon their life tonight in Jesus' name. Thank you for the answer. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. You can please be seated. If you have closely observed, you might have discovered that the best things in life are free, but it takes effort to possess them. Gold, for instance, or petroleum, the economic mainstay of our nation, and other materials are freely provided by God in the soil. But it takes a lot of effort to prospect for them and mine them for our benefit. God, in His infinite mercy and kindness, has an inheritance prepared for all of us. In fact, if you look at the account of the Bible on creation, you will see that God has provided everything that man will need for his earthly enjoyment before creating man. He created the light, the oceans, the streets, the forests, the animals, and all that man will feed upon before creating man. So, you can see that God did not intend or create man for suffering, for failure, for defeat, for disappointment. God has an inheritance prepared for us and for the children of Israel. Before He delivered them from the land of Egypt, He has prepared Canaan, a land flowing with milk and honey. But enjoying the benefits of Canaan, we take some efforts from the Israelites. Why? Because the Canaanites were there, the Gagasites were there, the Jebusites were there, the Perizzites were there. Seven nations mightier and greater than them. These nations must be dispossessed. They must be driven out before the Israelites could then enter in into their possession. And that is why tonight all the inheritances, the blessings, the abundance, the success, the promotion, the earthly joy that God has prepared for you, they are there. And tonight you will possess them. But there may be some Canaanites to fight. Some Gagasites may be there to be dislodged. Some enemies may be there who are withholding your blessing. Because, as I said earlier on, all that happens in the natural, they are determined in the spiritual. Wherever the enemies are ganging together, and they are conspired against you, and they are saying the success, the exaltation, the blessing, the promotion that God has earmarked for you, that it will not be your portion. Tonight, you are going to subdue those enemies. And you are going to possess your possession tonight in Jesus' name. I'm talking to you on the message, possessing your possession. You will possess them. I say you will possess them. God did not create you so that you will be a mystery. God did not create you as an unfortunate individual. No, He didn't create you so that you'll be a misfit. He didn't create you a failure. He has good intentions, good desires, good purposes for you. And you are going to realize that tonight in Jesus' name. In Numbers chapter 27, I read from verse 1 through 7. Numbers chapter 27, reading from verse 1. Then came the daughters of Selophiah, the son of Ephah, the son of Gilead, the son of Makkah, the son of Manasseh, of the family of Manasseh, the son of Joseph. And these are the names of his daughters, Mahala, Noah, and Hogla, and Milcah, and Asher. And they stood before Moses, and before Eleazar, the priest, and before the princes, and all the congregation, by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, saying, our father died in the wilderness. And he was not in the company of them that gathered together, themselves together against the law in the company of Korah, but died in his own sin. I had no sons. Why should the name of our father be done away from among his family? Because he had no son. Give unto us therefore a possession among the brethren of our father. And Moses brought their cause before the Lord. I'm bringing your cause before the Lord tonight. And the Lord said unto Moses, saying, the daughters of Selophiah speak right. Thou shalt surely give them a possession of an inheritance among their father's brethren, and thou shalt cause the inheritance of their father to pass on to them. These people pleaded for their inheritance. And before this time, it has never been so done in Israel that an inheritance of a father will be passed to the daughter. No. When the father dies, the head of a family in Israel, the inheritance will automatically and naturally pass on to the son, the first son. And that was why there was this, arrangement God has made for them, that the firstborn in Israel we have an inheritance of double portion. It was unfortunate for Reuben, of the sons of Jacob, that he misbehaved and then he missed his own inheritance. And the inheritance passed on, to Joseph. That's why he had double portion of blessing. And so on and so forth. But in the case of Selophiah had no man child. All his children were women. And now, that means automatically the inheritance, will just pass on to other families. But the daughters of Selophiah wrote up. And they went to Moses and said, our father actually was a true Israelite, a Jew, and a sincere and faithful Israelite. But then, he has passed on. And there's no mankind to claim his inheritance. Here we are. Shall we lose the possession of our father's inheritance because our father had no man child? Now give unto us our inheritance for a possession. And Moses was confused. It has never so happened that an inheritance will be passed to daughters, female child. So he went before the Lord to inquire what to do. And God told Moses, these daughters of Selophiah, they have spoken right. Cause the inheritance of their fathers to pass on unto them. There are inheritance of your father, your heavenly father, the almighty God, that he has prepared for you. He created you to be the head, not the tail. He created you to be above only, not be beneath. He created you to be an achiever. He created you to be a success. He created you to be a winner, not a loser, not a defeat, not a misfit, not a drag of the society. He didn't create you so that you'll be an unfortunate individual, living from hand to mouth, always striving, walking like an elephant and hitting like rat. That was not the grand design and desire of God at your creation. But it's unfortunate that the enemy came, Satan, the archenemy of God and man. He came and he hijacked the blessing of man. a start upon the blessing of, you know, of man in the spiritual realm, and then he taught man to be wandering in darkness, in deceit. But we want to thank God that a deliverer has come more than 2,000 years ago in the person of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who came to deliver us from our arch enemy, to release unto us our inheritance, which has freely been given unto us by God. Thus, before you will possess this possession, there's a battle to fight. Every man is born to fight. Life is a battlefield. I'm sure you know that. For a sinner, life is a battle. For a believer, that's double battle. To be a minister, if I have more than three battles, let me say three plus battles. We fight so as to possess the possessions that God has given to us. And whosoever will not fight may have his inheritance, his possessions withheld from him in perpetuity. And though the battle is not physically seen, but the effect is undoubtedly felt. The word fight that you find in the Bible, wrestle, strive, war, that you find in the scriptures, indicate that there is a battle always going on. Satan, who is the half enemy of God and man, is the one that we are fighting against. Because he is the one that opposes anything that is good. And Satan can never do good. The day he does good, he ceases to be a devil. You know the meaning of devil? You know the meaning of Satan? Satan means an adversary. It means an opposer. It means someone who opposes everything good. And when you are happy, Satan is unhappy. When you are successful, Satan is the failure. When you are making progress, Satan is the loser. And because it doesn't, you know, it's not, it won't settle down for failure. It will do everything possible in the realm of the possible to withhold and to hinder anyone from succeeding, enjoying peace and harmony. So, to possess our possessions, we have to fight. Not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. The battle we are talking about is not physical. It's not the one you fight with the, you know, with your feet. Not the one you fight with your hand. No. We're talking about spiritual warfare. And here tonight, you are going to fight and win, and Satan is going to lose the battle on your behalf, on your life, in Jesus' name. In Ephesians chapter 6, let's see the confirmation of what I'm talking about. Ephesians chapter 6. Reading there, in verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. You will never see in the Bible where you are counseled to be weak in the Lord. Where you are counseled or exhorted or admonished to be weak in the Lord. Where you are, you know, encouraged to be a feeble Christian. Just a partial Christian. Just a John Wear Christian. No. Butter and bread Christian. You're not going to find that in the Bible. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that he may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we arrest you. We are not at ease in Zion. We arrest you. We are not playing. We arrest you. We are not joking, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against power, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Those are the emissaries of Satan that collaborate with him to oppose man in his progress, in his success, in his joy and happiness. Wherefore, for starting, take unto you a whole armor of God, that he may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand, to withstand. You will not fall. You will stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always, not talking always. Praying always, not murmuring always. Praying always, not complaining always. Praying always, not sinning always. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all sins. But then, we are told, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, not physical, not earthly, not material weapons, not guns and bullets. No, not cutlasses and spear. No, I'm talking about spiritual weapon. How do we fight it? We fight it by repenting from our sin, becoming a child of God, being free from the dominion of sin. We fight it by turning our life to Christ and enlisting God's own army. We fight it by being born again. Then, after you are born again, we fight it by the knowledge of the Word of God. We fight it with prayer. We fight it with strong intercession. Tonight, I'm talking to you on 3 points. Number one, believer's possession. And many good things God has prepared for you. Many, many blessings that God has prepared for you. That's why, not for the enemy of your soul, the adversary of your life. I'm telling you, you will not have remained at this level. You will have become a spiritual giant. You will have become a great success. You will have become a great achiever. But from tonight, you will begin to claim your possession. You will begin to possess your possession. And God will actualize every good thing He has earmarked for you in Jesus' name. Number one, believer's possession. We'll look at that in the Word of God. Then number two, believer's striving to possess their possession. I told you, the good things of life, they are free. God makes them free. But for human beings to enjoy those good things, it takes some effort, some striving. Talk of petroleum. You need to go to, you know, the Niger Delta, go to the ocean side and see all the efforts, you know, constructing all those rigs, going inside, prospecting for oil, you know, and all that, before it is eventually refined, and then you have it, you know, and that's the crude oil, eventually comes to petroleum, comes to kerosene, gasoline, aviation oil, and all the rest that we use that make life conducive and comfortable for us. It takes efforts. Not only that, you talk of gold. Gold is free. Nobody plants gold. Not planted. Nobody, you know, produces it. No, it's free. It's there in the ground. God provided it there. But for you to enjoy that gold, to mine it and utilize it, of course, man needs to, you know, do a lot of effort. So also in the spiritual realm. The blessings of God are free, but then it takes some effort, some striving before you enjoy it for a possession. So, point number two then, believers striving to possess their possession. Then number three, believers support in battle. We are not alone. We are not alone in this battle. We have the power of God backing us all. We have the Spirit of God. We have the presence of God. We have the promises of Scripture. We have the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And we have faith that we can put in place so that we will then have our blessings that is already provided for us for possession. Let's look at point number one, believer's possession. Let's look at the text in Numbers chapter 27. Numbers chapter 27. I read there from verses 1 through 4. Numbers 27, verses 1 through 4. Then came the daughters of Zelophehad. They needed to come. They needed to rise up to the challenge of their time. They needed to put up action. They just sat down there, folding their hands. thinking that, you know, the blessing will just drop down, whether they make effort or not, of course, they will have been disappointed. Then came the daughters of Zelophehad. And thank God you have come tonight to the presence of God. Your blessing will not be denied you. It will not elude you tonight. God will catapult you from your present level to a higher level in Jesus' name. Then came the daughters of Zelophehad, the son of Ephah, the son of Gilead, the son of Makkah, the son of Manasseh, of the families of Manasseh, the son of Joseph. And these are the names of his daughters: Mahala, Noah, Hogla, Amilca, and Tapsa. And they stood before Moses, and before Eleazar the priest, and before the princes and all the congregation, by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, saying, "Our father died in the wilderness, and he was not in the company of them that gathered themselves together against the Lord in the company of Korah, but died in his own strength and had no son. Why should the name of our father be done away from among his family? Because he had no son. Give unto us therefore a possession among the brethren of our father." These people, they came. And they made a plea. They gave blessings, and they made their requests, and eventually God intervened on their behalf. Tonight, God will intervene in your affair. Heaven will plead your cause before God. And tonight, mercy, God will do something wonderful in your life. Believers, possessions. God does not save us only and leave us in this world. He has made adequate provisions for all that we need till we see Him face to face. All that we need that will make life comfortable, enjoyable, happy for us, He has provided them. These provisions, they are innumerable. All that the heart can wish, God has provided them for us. Let's see just some of them. In John chapter 3, John Gospel chapter 3, I read there in verse 3. John Gospel chapter 3, I read in verse 3. Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." In verse 5, John, Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee." I mean, if these things were not important, Jesus would not have been emphasizing and re-emphasizing it here. "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Chapter 1 of the 10th book of John. I read in verse 11. John 1, verse 11. "He came unto his own." He came to the Jews. "But his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God." To become, which means they were not originally. They were not God's children originally. But now, because they took that step of faith, because they made up their mind to receive him as their Lord and Savior, he gave them power to become sons of God. Even to them that believe on his name. Look at what's happening there. "Which were born, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." When you came to this world, you were born by the will of man. It was your father that decided to marry your mother. And it was the agreement of your father and mother to have you as a child, as a son, or as a daughter. That aptly natural birth. That one is facilitated by the will of man, by the desire of man. And when we are talking about spiritual birth now, the second birth, and this one is not of man, but is of God. It was God himself that planned it, that designed it, and put it in place for man's enjoyment. Which were born, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the world with capital W, was made flesh, and dwell among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Spiritual birth. God has provided that for all. Paul, including you, my friend, including you, including everybody here. God provided it freely. You don't pay anything for it. You don't struggle for it. It's done by God himself. It's made available for you to enjoy. Spiritual birth. And then you say, if God has provided it for men, why is it that all men are not saved? Look at the answer there. All men are not saved because not all men have received him as their Savior and their Lord. Look at it in verse 11. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. Maybe you are one of those that receive him not. Because you are his own by creation. We are all created by God. We are all children of God by creation. But mind you, you will never be able to fully enjoy the blessing and the favor of God until you have become his child by redemption. Because all that sin and have come short of the glory of God. The sin that you inherited, the sin that you committed, has turned you an enemy of God. And therefore, even though you are his child by creation, you have become his enemy by sin. And therefore, you need a redeemer. You need a mediator. You need an intermediary between you and God. And that's in the person of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's your wisdom tonight to receive him into your life. It's your wisdom tonight to surrender your life unto him. It's your wisdom tonight to allow the eternal blood that he shed on the cross of Calvary for atonement, for redemption, to flow into your life and wash away your sin. And you become free, and free indeed. And then that salvation that you now enjoy, that now comes into your life, will now open the door of God's blessing for you. Because as an enemy of God, even though God loves you as a person, he hates your sin, and in your sin, you are his enemy. And as an enemy, you cannot enjoy the best of God. So then, we have these blessings already provided for us. But apart from salvation, I told you, salvation is just the gateway to the pool of God's blessing, to the abundance of God, to the provisions of God. After salvation, he opens that door for you to begin to enjoy. But then don't forget, you still have to fight. You still have to ask. You still have to pray. You still have to discover what is written concerning you. And it is when you discover what is written that you can now go before the Lord like a solicitor before a judge, and you can say, Father, in your prayer now, it is written, such and such. And it shall be unto you according to your petition tonight in Jesus' name. Look at Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1. We are looking at believers' blessings. And we have seen the first blessing, the blessing of redemption, the blessing of salvation. In fact, without that, you are not even a believer to start with. But then, after that, then you have all other blessings so innumerable that whatever your heart could desire, could wish, is already there in the package for you. Joshua chapter 1, I read in verse 8. This book of the law, the Bible, shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have. Tell me the rest. Tell me the rest. Say it out loud. Say it like you are claiming it tonight. It shall be your portion in Jesus' name. That is part of the provision that God has made for your earthly enjoyment. He didn't create you to be a failure, to be a non-entity. to be a dollar. That you went to class, you were taught something, and you have textbooks, and you have your computers, and you have all other sources of information. And then you have the timetable, you have this information, you have this, time lag to prepare. And then you get to exam hall, and the things you have read, and the things you have been taught, and the things you have come across in your research, in your private, personal, reading, that you now get to exam hall, and they are asking you the same question, and then your mind goes blank. And then there is disappearance of points. And then you cannot remember. And then you are fidgeting. And then you cannot, coordinate yourself. And then you are performing below your original ability. No, that's not the design of God. I'm telling you, in this exam, you will perform at your optimum best in Jesus' name. Because that is the grand design and desire of God. And as you go before the Lord and say, God, see what you have said concerning me. See what is written concerning me. And then, see what you have done for me. I come now as a child, as your son, as your daughter. And I'm asking, Father, give unto me my possession. Just like the daughters of Selophia did. And if God will grant the desire of the Selophia, which before time was not the normal thing in Israel, how much more? The normal thing. The expressly written thing that we can see in the Bible. Tonight, there shall be actualization of the reality of your blessing in Jesus' name. In Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. I read there in verse 3. Ephesians chapter 1. Reading verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Thank God. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessings without exception. All spiritual blessings that made for your earthly peace, comfort, satisfaction. He has made all those things available for us. In 2 Peter chapter 1, I read in verse 3. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. According as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of things that has called us unto glory and virtue. So you can see there, God has prepared all spiritual blessings for our earthly enjoyment. Mark Gospel, chapter 7. Mark Gospel, chapter 7. I read there in verse 27. But Jesus said unto her, let the children first be filled, for it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it unto God. Here was a Syrophoenician woman. Her daughter had the problem of epilepsy. Sometimes the epilepsy will, seize him and land him in fire. At other times, the epilepsy spirit will seize, this daughter and land the daughter in water. And it made the hell of the life of that daughter. Eventually, this Syrophoenician woman heard about Jesus. And he came to Jesus, kneeling down, pleading that, he has the problem of my daughter. And I've taken this, my daughter, to your disciples. They couldn't heal her. Now, I'm coming unto you. Lord, have mercy on my daughter and heal her. And Jesus said, no, it shouldn't be like that. You are not born again. You are not a child of God by redemption. Although a child of God by creation, but not a child of God by redemption. Your sins are not yet forgiven. It has not sought the first blessing forth. Because he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Then all other things will be added. Let you have placed a cart before the horse. You have not sought first the first thing. You have misplaced priority. And so Jesus said, no, it is not good to cast children bread unto doors. Sinners are spiritual doors. And you know the natural does. You know the way they do. They don't think about shame. Anywhere a male dog meets a female dog, they just mate together openly. There's no shame about it. And you know the lifestyle of many sinners. There's no shame about it. They even advertise their body. The sacredness of the body, they just expose it, you know, to men as ladies. And they don't see anything, you know, wrong about it. They just live a life of promiscuity and sin and immorality. Little wonder Jesus called them dogs. So Jesus, it's not good to cast children's bread onto dogs. Now, the point is this. This woman was seeking deliverance for her daughter. And Jesus, by implication, was saying that healing and deliverance is children's bread. How many of you are God's children tonight? Let me see your hand up. I'm not talking of children of God by creation. I'm talking of children of God by redemption. If you are not one, God will make you one tonight in Jesus' name. Now, what you are saying is this. Healing is children's bread. Deliverance is children's bread. If you are sick tonight, if you have sought the face of God for salvation of your soul, then healing is your entitlement. It's your bona fide right. You can claim it and you experience it tonight in Jesus' name. And if you are oppressed, deliverance is your right. You have claim to it. And it shall be unto you according to your desire tonight in Jesus' name. So then, God has all these provisions for us. Healing of all sicknesses, deliverance from all oppressions and bondages, that has been made available for us in the spiritual realm. In Luke chapter 13, I read there in verse 16. Luke 13, verse 16. And ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound, lo, these 18 years, be loosed from his bound, from this bound on the Sabbath day? Here we see the case of another woman. The woman was bent down. She couldn't stand upright. And then the woman came, you know, to Jesus on the Sabbath day. And you know, it was against the rule of the Jews that work be done on Sabbath day. But then the Pharisees and the Sadducees that were there to accuse Jesus of working on Sabbath day, Jesus turned unto them and he said, which one of you, after your sheep fall into the pit on the Sabbath, and will not lift up that sheep? Up not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, be loosed, whom Satan has bound, lo, these 18 years. I told you, Satan is a force behind all evils, all calamities, all misfortunes, all failures, all disappointments. Satan is at the back of all evil that plague the sons of men. Jesus emphasizes here that it was Satan that bound that woman. God did not create him that way. So Jesus turned to the Pharisee, ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound, no, these 18 years, be loosed from my infirmity? And if there's any infirmity upon you there, that Satan has put upon your body, tonight you are loosed in Jesus' name. That is part of our entitlement in the kingdom. In Acts chapter 1, I read in verse 18, where in Acts chapter 1, verse 18, that's talking about Holy Ghost power. That's your portion. That you are baptized, you are filled, with the Holy Ghost. That is your portion. And you ask for it tonight, it's going to be your possession. In John chapter 14, John 14, verse 27. 27. Peace I give to you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth. Give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. That's part of the provisions of the kingdom. God has made provision for that. Your peace, that will be at peace. That nothing, you know, troubles your mind. No confusion. That you're just, you enjoy life. I was in the office today, you know, when a woman, you know, came in, you know, to see me at the secretariat. Actually not a counseling day, but, you know, she came at a time that I traveled then. Then eventually she decided to come today. And then when she started narrating our day of how, you know, together with the husband, they married in affluence, in wealth. And God really prospered them. Spent many years in London, in US, and many other countries. Things were going on fine with them. But eventually, this election policies came up some 4 years ago, and the husband decided that she wanted to come in, you know, and participate in politics. Then eventually came in, and then, I don't need to go into all the details. To cut a long story short, eventually he was edged out. And then, because so much money has been spent and all that, he had to now resort into, you know, consulting with, you know, these people on the mountain, people in the valley, you know, and all these herbalists and all these spiritic people and all the candle burning and the incense burning, white garments and all the rest. To cut a long story short, he started defining for him and said, look, your wife is the one behind your problem. You are hedged out of, you know, that political, you know, office because your wife is a witch. And to cut a long story short, come and see a happy home. All overnight. And the man would bring out a cutlass and say, look, you are sitting on gunpowder. And any time, the powder can explode. To cut a long story short, the woman has to flee for their life. You see, there's trouble in this world. And Satan is at the back of it all. And if you don't have Christ in your life, I'm telling you, you are just a fowl in the poultry of Satan. And any time he can bring you out for his slaughter. But I pray, Satan will not use you for Christmas in Jesus' name. That's all the trouble, you know, you find in the world. I can replicate so many stories, you know, along that line. Homes that Satan has scattered. And a lot of heartaches and troubles of life that people are passing through who don't know Jesus. Who don't have Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And who are not strong in the Lord and in the power of His mind. Then we thank God. In Christ Jesus, there is peace. Does He say, no Christ, and no peace. Then, no, the first no now, K-N-O-W, no Christ and no peace. Then the other one now, no N-O, no Christ and no peace. A life without Christ is a life full of crisis. That's why tonight it's your wisdom to run to the Savior and be saved. There are many blessings that God has prepared for us. 1 Corinthians, Chapter 15. Let's just read verse 57. 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, reading verse 57. But thanks be to God, which has given us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's another thing there. You have victory. There might be battles in life. Your victory is assured through our Lord Jesus. Only through our Lord Jesus Christ. Many, many blessings. I read 3 John, verse 2. 3 John, that's after Hebrews, you go to 1 Peter, you go to James, then 1 Peter, 2 Peter, then you get to 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John. I read in verse 2, 3 John verse 2, it's not only one chapter. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. That's the plan of God, that you prosper in your vocation, in your career, in your business. In your active pursuits, and those of you who are non-students, you are going to prosper. I say you are going to prosper. In Job chapter 27. Job chapter 27. Job chapter 27. I read there. Alright. I think I missed my reference there. The passage I want to read is where it says, "For promotion cometh not from the east, nor from the west, but God is the judge." Now, there, your promotion is assured. As a civil servant, as a lecturer, as an administrative staff, or as a businesswoman, your promotion is assured in Jesus' name. These are just some of the blessings that so many, many professions that have been made for us. God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings, all that pertain unto life and godliness, healing, deliverance, peace, power, victory, prosperity, all are possessions of believers. And all that the believers need to live conveniently have been made available by God. However, it is so pathetic. Despite all these provisions, many still live as destitute. The reason may be because they are not ready to strive for their possession. But tonight, we will strive. And we will strive lawfully. Because we have to strive lawfully when we are striving. That takes me to point number two, believers striving to possess their possession. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 12. There the Bible says, right from the time of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, and the violence take it by force. Not the violence of a looter. Not the violence of rebellion. Not the violence of, bonfire on the road. No. We are talking about spiritual violence. That very shortly now, I'm going to lead you in prayer. And I will raise prayer points from here. You will not just close your mouth while others are praying. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Some people say, it's not the song you sing while you kneel down. You'll be violent in your prayer. You had that last testifier. He said he never knew how to pray. But then somebody, brought him here with a banana. Thank God for that banana. And then eventually he found himself praying. Tonight you will pray likewise. And you will possess your possession in Jesus' name. In Job chapter 13, I read in verse 19. Job 13, verse 19. Who is he that will plead with me? For now, if I hold my tongue, I shall give up the ghost. Job knew the importance of prayer. Say, if I hold my tongue, if I don't pray, mischief will happen. Evil will occur. And the reason why many children of God suffer wrong, suffer lack, suffer, the fulfillment of their heart's desire is because of failure to pray. In Luke Gospel chapter 16, I read there in verse 16. Luke 16:16. The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presses unto it. Look at that verse closely. The law and the prophets have been until John. And since that time, the kingdom has been preached, and every man presses into it. Of course, before you were born, the gospel has been preached. After you have been born, the gospel is still being preached. And even tonight, gospel is still being preached. But for you to enjoy the blessings of the gospel, you have an effort to make. You must press into it. Of course, as you are trying to give your life to Jesus, maybe you are here with your boyfriend as a lady. And your boyfriend will be telling you, you want to join them? You want to leave me? No, you can't do that. We have to continue together. After all, I brought you. And then you need to now press. That's where the violence now comes in. That's when you now need to snatch yourself, you know, and say, I've heard the truth. I'm not going to allow this opportunity to bypass me. I'm going to seize this chance. I'm going to surrender my life to Jesus. How many of you are there? You say, well, they only invited me here. I'm not interested in giving my life to Jesus. You know, and all that. I belong to this other religion or this and that. But here you are hearing the truth. And, you know, the Spirit of God is telling you, this is the right thing to do. And then there will be a striving, a kind of, argument, controversy. The violence coming when you will now have to deliver yourself like a roe from the hunter, like a bird from the fowler, and say, I'm not going to allow this opportunity to pass me by. Tonight is my night, and tonight will be your night. You heard that, all those testifier giving testimonies, that it wasn't just the physical blessing first, but the attestation first. And I remember September 14, 1983. When I took this decision, of course, I was from the other religion. I mean, I used to be the one that would make the noise, wake people up for prayer, 5 a.m. in the morning. And the 30-day Ramadan fast, I never missed it. And then continuing all that. But I had all these bad things in my life. Was a cheat. And if you play with your booze when I was in school, you will regret. And eventually, when I was in Form 5, you know, in our own days, there was no SS1, SS2, you are talking about now. They made a mistake. They appointed me as a librarian. I said, good luck to you. All the good books in the library, stone and cosy, modern biology, I stole it. Chemistry textbook, I stole it. Admas, name it. Any good book. Thank God I became born again later. And I repented in dust and ashes. I heard about restitution. And I bought brand new books of all those good books. I returned it back to school. The principal was saying, what has happened to you? You used to be a good boy. I said, sir, I was a bad boy. You are judging by appearance. Because I appear gentle. It's more than that. And tonight, look at yourself. Understand your good moral. Being good, you know, morally good. That cannot save you. Not the labor of my hands can fulfill thy Lord's demands. Thou must say, and thou alone. Only through the blood. Only through the blood. Not religion. Religion cannot. The Pharisees were religious. The Sadducees were religious. But they were sinners. And any religion that does not deliver you from the bondage of sin will land you in hell. Because the only thing that turns you against God, that makes you an adversary of God, is sin. It's not your dressing. It's not your praying so many times a day. It's not your, you know, religious activities. It is sin. So if you are saying your life, don't justify yourself that says, you know, you are religious, you know, and all that. Satan is preparing you for hell. I pray you will escape. So, we need to strive to get all our blessings. A big tree at the backyard of a thirsty man will be useless to him unless he goes to take a little to quench his thirst. Think about it. We say all these blessings are provided. But if you are not getting them, if you cannot pray them in, if you cannot receive them through prayer, then those blessings, they are useless. It has a big river behind you at your backyard. And here you are dying of thirst. Of what use is that river? Therefore tonight, you will strive. And you will possess your possession. Satan will not close your mouth. The adversary, Satan, the enemy, will not hinder you to pray. At the time of prayer, some people will be dozing. At the time of prayer, they are in your name. You say, it's like they don't have anything to say. How many things to say? Just like I talk to you, you talk to me. The same way you relate with the Father, you commune with God, Heaven will answer you in Jesus' name. And if you are here, you have come to write post you and me. This is the exam that will determine your being a student here next semester or next session. You don't joke with this kind of prayer. I congratulate those of you that are in that category, because heaven will fill your mouth with testimony tonight in Jesus' name. You know, one of the testifiers, you know, gave that testimony. You will give your own next year. So, we've got to strive to possess our possessions. Though, we must strive lawfully. And I say strive, we must strive how? Lawfully. See that in 2 Timothy chapter 2. I read in verse 5. 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy, please open your Bible. You must read this one if you have one. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Are we there? I'm waiting for you. 2 Timothy chapter 2, reading there in verse 5. We are there. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet is he not crowned, except he strive how? Lawfully. Everybody prays. Evil thieves, they pray when they are going for operation. They pray that they may not be caught. Abalis, they pray. I've had one abalis. I was, I went to a friend's place, and I there happened to be an abalis, you know, very close to their house. A woman came to, you know, receive due power to kill an individual. And when the abalis finished all the, you know, charm and everything, and placed it, you know, in the hand of this woman to go and use to kill an individual, he said, may it work in God's name. The charm that will kill somebody, may it work in God's name. Only Olorun ajeoje o. So when we talk about prayer, do you think God answers all prayer? I'm asking you. It's not all prayers that go beyond the ceiling. Many of the prayers don't even reach the ceiling. Your prayer, I pray tonight, your prayer will not be back to the sender. Your prayer will penetrate. It will reach the target. And it will bring down the needed blessing in Jesus' name. For then, you must strive lawfully. How do we strive lawfully? Or how do we strive unlawfully? See that in Romans chapter 6. Romans. Please, make sure you read this one. Romans chapter 6. Are we there? In verse 1. What shall we say then? That we continue in sin, that grace may abound? What's the answer, church? The answer is in verse 2. God forbid. You continue sitting in exam, and you are praying for a grace. You continue in immorality, in impersonation, and you are praying, oh God, I must be the head and not the tail. Of what use is your being the head? Of what benefit is your being above and not being beneath? And so then, let us strive lawfully. Pray acceptably. Your prayer must be acceptable to God. We are taking time here to define prayer for you. Because many people pray, but they don't understand what they are doing. What's prayer? Prayer is the offering up of our desires to God for things that are agreeable to Him with thankful acknowledgement of His mercies. That's prayer. Offering up, you must open your mouth, say it out. Not meditation. Some people will be doing like this when they are praying. And they are just doing that. They're not saying anything. That's not prayer. Prayer is not meditation. Open wide your mouth, for I will fill it. You must open up, say something, express a desire. Prayer is the offering up of our desires unto God for things agreeable to His will. The thing of the agreeable to the will of God. If it goes off tangent, if it's against the scripture, if it doesn't fall in line with the will of God, of course, you cannot use prayer to bribe God. Prayer is not a labor device to bribe God. So then, we strive. But then, we strive lawfully. I pray we strive lawfully tonight in Jesus' name. What is the method of our, what is the means of our striving? Of course, in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 and 4. Although we walk in the flesh, though we are human beings, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God. Now, the knowledge of God we have is that we shall succeed. Is that whatever we lay our hands upon, we shall prosper. We shall succeed. Now, but in your own life, you discover that whatever you lay your hand upon, you don't prosper. You discover that any exam you write, you don't succeed. You discover in your life that God says, I will bless your bread and water. Nothing good will I withhold from you because you are walking upright. But you discover that good things are being withheld from you. Those are the things that are exalting themselves against your own knowledge of God. And the Bible says, casting down imaginations. And every high thing that exalted itself, that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Whatever is exalting itself against the knowledge of God in your life, tonight, you are casting them down. And you will possess your own possession in Jesus' name. So then, the means for our striving are not carnal. Because the warfare is not physical. We need holiness of life, righteousness of life. We need faith. We need prayer. We need obedience to God's command. We need the word of God for our warfare. These are the weapons we are using. These are the weapons. And tonight, they are mighty. To the pulling down of strongholds in your life in Jesus' name. Then the method of our striving. The method of our striving varies. Number one, it may be individual striving. Of course, you have your own personal request, personal prayer, personal desire, personal expectation. Of course, you will take that to God in prayer. Individual. And you find that in Genesis chapter 32 from verse 24, we are Jacob all alone, rescued with God. And he has the desire of his life met. So, we can do that, and we are going to do that tonight. But, apart from that, we have a corporate or agreement striving. That's in Matthew chapter 18, verses 19 and 20. Again, I see unto you, if two of you shall agree together, as touching anything, that if I have the Father, it shall be done unto them of my Father that is in heaven. And I stand here as an individual to join my faith with your own faith, to join my faith with your own faith, to join my faith with your own faith, and whatsoever which I bind here on earth tonight shall be bound in heaven. And whatever we lose here on earth tonight shall be loosed in heaven. And you will possess your own possession in Jesus' name. Finally, believers support in virtue. We have seen the case of daughters of Phelophia in Numbers 27. Now in verses 6 and 7, we see here that Moses took their cause to God, and we see that God supported their cause. God will support your cause. Tonight, your expectations are not the cause short. And then in Isaiah chapter 43, Isaiah chapter 43, let's read the first. There, I read in verse 2. When thou passest through the water, I will be with thee. Amen. Is that how much you can say, amen? Amen. When thou passest through the water, I will be with thee. Amen. And through the river, they shall not overflow thee. Amen. And when thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. That is the support of God, the promises of God that are backing you up. And no matter, you know, what your situation is, if every moment the Lord will arise and fight your battle for you against all your enemies in Jesus' name. In chapter 41 of Isaiah, I read in verse 14. Isaiah 41, verse 14. Fear not, thou one Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help thee. Fear the Lord. See what God is saying to you and see your response. And thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. God is saying in this exam, fear not, because he will be with you. In verse 15, behold, I will make thee a new sharp stretching instrument, having teeth, and thou shalt tread the mountains, and beat them small, and shalt make the hills as chaff. You will conquer all your papers in Jesus' name. As we fight for our possession, God's promises to support us receive you. The forthcoming exam or this ongoing exam, God will back you up. He will fulfill all your dreams. He will perform your expectations. Nothing good will be kept from you in Jesus' name. Let's rise up our feet and begin to possess our possession. We are striving now. It's the time to strive. What's your desire? What do you want God to do for you in this post-UME exam? And in the upcoming undergraduate exam, or your forthcoming postgraduate exam, it is time for you to call upon the Lord. Don't allow any hindrance. Don't allow anybody to talk to you. It's not the time of talking. That boy in front, please, it's time to pray. Don't be used of the devil. Call upon the Lord. It is time to pray. In Jesus' name we pray. You are here to strive tonight. And you will strive to possess your possession in Jesus' name. Don't forget, right from the time of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom is being preached and every man presses into it. He will answer every prayer. He will answer. What to God is it? Believing it. He answers every prayer. My God is my God will answer. Go to God is it? Believing it. He answers for the last time. It will answer. My God will answer. Go to Him in faith, believing He will answer. Amen. Concerning this exam, I want you to open your mouth and call upon Him for your desire. we pray. Amen. Concerning the papers you have written, go to God now in prayer. Lecturer opened his mouth and said, "Look, what you score in my course does not depend on what you write down. It all depends on the mood in which I am when I'm marking the script." Now, the lecturers there, they are not different from the lecturers here. They are all human beings. Concerning all your lecturers, go to God in prayer now. Depends on what you wrote. It all depends on my mood when I am marking. Now, not only that, if it depends on his mood, your own performance too depends on your condition of health during your exam. Concerning your health, you will go to God now in prayer. Any sickness in your body? Any disease in your body? Any attack or Satan? Go to God in prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For God to even answer your prayer is a function of your spiritual condition. I want you to take your spiritual life unto God in prayer. Are you a child of God? Or you are a backslider? Is your name written in the book of life? Are you born again? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Not all of us are students, non-students among us. And we also have expectations. And you also have parents too among them. Or maybe far back at home. And your success also determines your own success. We want to take the condition of our parents, and if you are a parent here, take it to God in prayer right now. They send money to you. They pray for you too. They provide for your needs. They visit you on the campus. Pray for them. They are trusted to be your concern. Pray for your father. Pray for your mother. Pray for your auntie. Pray for your guardian. And all our non-students, you will protect your own protection too. Protect your own protection. Protect your own possession. Protect your own possession. We are striving to protect our possession. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I say amen. Finally, there are some expectations in your heart. There are some desires. There are some wishes. There are things you want God to do for you apart from passing your exam. Now, all those things, take them to God in prayer. Take them to God in prayer. He will answer you. He will answer you. I say, He will answer you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What is today's date, please? 8th of go and write it down in your diary. God will do something new in your life in Jesus' name. Something remarkable. Something unforgettable. Something eternal. Something supernatural. Something supernatural. God will do it in Jesus' name. And amen. Let's start at the right point. You want to surrender your life to Jesus. You want to be born again. You want to quit sin. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. If tonight you want to join the army of God's children, renewed and born again by the blood of the Lamb, can I see your hands up? You know it after you have not been born again. It after God does not recognize you as a saved soul, tonight is your night. I told you my own testimony. It happened September 14, 1983. Since that time until now, my life has never been the same again. Electronics, please help me. Now you are giving your life to Jesus. There's no shame about you tonight. Open your eyes, come forward here. Come forward here. No shame about you. Come forward. I did my own September 14, 1983. Come forward. God bless you. God is waiting for the rest of you. You raise up your hand, come forward. Don't just raise it up, open your eyes. Please give way for them, let them pass. I'm waiting for you. You want to turn a new leaf. You want to give your life to Jesus. You want to be born again. Come forward, the Lord is calling you. The Lord is calling you. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Please come to this side. Come up here. Yes. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Shall we continue in lying? Shall we continue in abusing people? Shall we continue in stealing? Shall we continue in cheating? Abound? I'm waiting for you. Don't let this opportunity bypass you. Let today mark your own day, the day of redemption, the day of deliverance, the day of repentance. The day of such a new thing. God bless you. Walk fast. The Lord is happy about you tonight. This you are taking tonight will mark the beginning of a new life in your life. Come forward. I'm waiting for you.
Please, you have to stay there
and face the pulpit. Stay there and face the pulpit. I'm waiting for the rest of you. Don't let this act of salvation bypass you. If the Lord Jesus is calling you, if the safety of your soul is calling you, I took this decision once upon a time, and tonight can be your own night. Come over. Don't let the act of salvation bypass you. In the day of Noah was warning the people. Noah warned the people, but they were making jest of Noah until the heart was closed. Come forward. Don't perish in Sodom. Come and take decision for Jesus. Come and repent of your sins. Which of you is wrong? I want you to bow down your head, close your eyes, open your mouth to God, repent of your sin, ask God to forgive you. He's a merciful God. We cannot continue in sin that grace may abound. We cannot continue in stealing, continue in cheating, continue in abusing people, calling nicknames, and committing immorality, and say we are children of God. We cannot continue in evil habits, and we say we are children of God, and we say we are Christians. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. Oh God, thou will not despise. I see some of them shedding tears. Yes, that's a godly sorrow for sin. That's a godly sorrow. God will forgive you. I see them shedding tears. Yes, you have to be sorry for your sin. It's not a laughing matter at all. It's a thing we do in deep confusion, in genuine repentance. It's a thing we are calling upon God for mercy. Ask God to forgive you. If you have been practicing Yahoo Yahoo, repent. You have been involved in all forms of impersonation, repent. Repent. Tell God to forgive you. Tell God to write your name in the book of life, promising that from tonight you will not return to your sin again. In Jesus' name we pray. Almighty God, I bring all of these your children before you. Before now, they've been your children by creation. But now, they want to become your children by redemption. Lord, behold the atoning blood on the cross of Calvary shed by the Lord Jesus Christ for redemption. Oh Lord, I'm asking in the name of Jesus, let this blood blot out their transgressions tonight in Jesus' name. Their sins which are many. Oh Lord, I pray, forgive them of all of them in Jesus' name. And the power to go and sin no more, oh Lord, bestow upon them now in Jesus' name. All the guilt of sin, all the remembrance of sin, all the condemnation of sin, let the blood of Jesus cancel it from their hearts in Jesus' name. Lord, from this very moment, make a new creature out of all of them. Write their name in the book of life. Count them among the congregation of the redeemed in Jesus' name. From this very night, receive power of adoption. The power of sons. The power of daughters. I pray from this very moment you will receive this power of adoption into the commonwealth of God, into the fold of Christ, into the company of the redeemed, into the assembly of saints of God, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for I know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. We are still praying. Tonight, it is finished on the cross. I say it is finished on the cross. Your failure is finished on the cross. Your carryover is finished on the cross. Your defeat is finished on the cross. If you are writing an exam, either post-UME exam, or the undergraduate exam, or postgraduate exam, and you raise up your hand as we pray together. Those hands are blessed. Those hands are marked with success. They are marked for success. They are marked for decision. They are marked for extraordinary performance. Heavenly Father, this answer I raise unto you. Dear Lord, behold all these hands, O Lord. Lord, mark these hands for excellent performance in examination in Jesus' name. Lord, behold these hands. And place on these hands the pen of a ready writer in Jesus' name. Any script that these hands write upon, Lord, mark it for success and breakthrough in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answered prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Your hands are blessed. Your head too must be blessed. Place your hands on your head. Heavenly Father, these are your people. These are your children. And you created us perfect. No faults. Dear Lord, all these heirs, anoint them for success in Jesus' name. The Bible says, the memory of the just is blessed. Lord, bless this memory. Bless this mind. Bless this intellect. Bless this conscious. Bless this subconscious. Bless their thinking. Bless their memory. Bless their understanding. Bless their wisdom. Holy Father, as they go into exam, I pray, oh Lord, all their friends, all that they have come across, all that they have come, that they have been taught, dear Lord, as they get into the exams and they read the question papers, Lord, grant them the recalling power in Jesus' name. Ability to interpret questions correctly, to answer questions in the right perspective, to write excellent answers. The soul is upon them now in Jesus' name. For every one of them, O Lord, be it for CME exam, undergraduate exam, postgraduate exam, Even doctorate exam, I decree and I declare this exam is a walkover for them all in Jesus' name. They will remember this day for good. 8th day of July, year 2010. Oh Lord, mark it for them as a day of breakthrough in Jesus' name. All the papers you have written and the ones you are yet to write, dear Lord, I pray, mark them for excellent performance in Jesus' name. And that lecturer says, your score does not depend on what you wrote down, but on the mood in which you are when I am marking. Dear Lord, I commit all the lecturers, the examiners, whether conference marking or individual marking, whether they are marking the truth in their homes, or they are marking it in their offices, whether they are marking it on the campus, or outside the campus, oh Lord, the lecturers, the examiners will mark their truth in their joyous moments in Jesus' name. They will enjoy the paper of the examiner. And when the examiner prints their paper, their biro, and they are marking their truth, they see everything correct. They see nothing to mark on. Where they seem not to have even put down everything perfectly. No, the only God is ministering to them, idea is what is needed. And they are marking everything right for them in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray the best result in the department. The best result in the faculty. The best result in the university. Let it come out of this congregation tonight in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for anointing answer. Possess your possession in Jesus' name. Amen. If you are sick in your body, you have read tonight, healing is children's bread. Healing is your bona fide right. You will place your hand where the sickness or the problem is. Whatever kind of problem, psychosomatic problem, physical problem, disease, sickness, affliction. Tonight, every anxiety of ordinances that are contrary to you, we are blocking them out. Father, behold your children. You say, I wish above all things that we live in health. This is your wish and this is our prayer. And when our prayer stands with your will, therefore, it receives instantaneous answer. Lord, I pray, let there be instantaneous healing upon every part of the body that you are laying your hands now in Jesus' name. Healing of the body. Healing of the mind. Healing of the soul. Healing. 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 Social healing. Psychological healing. Spiritual healing. Physical healing. Physiological healing. I confirm total and instantaneous healing now in Jesus' name. Any kind of oppression there, I command you oppression, come out in Jesus' name. Jesus said, my peace I give unto you. Not as the Lord Jesus, give I unto you. Lord, I'm asking, the peace that Jesus gives, Lord, let it be the apostle in Jesus' name. Where there is trouble, where there is confusion, Lord, I command every storm, every confusion, Lord, clear out in Jesus' name. The peace of God shall rest upon your mind, shall rest upon your soul, shall rest upon your body, shall rest upon your intellect. Even in your exam, I decree peace in Jesus' name. You are blessed. You are healed. You are delivered. You are successful. In Jesus' name. Father, I pray for those who are non-students, lecturers, academic, non-academic staff that are here tonight. Lord, I've heard about the testimony of how you promoted the father of one of us here. Lord, this is just the beginning. I pray, oh Lord, do this all and sundry in Jesus' name. Whether they are here physically, or they are represented by their wives or children, Lord, I pray, lift up their heads. Promote them. Exalt them. Mighty God of heaven, I pray, this is your exercise that is ongoing. Lord, remember your people for promotion in Jesus' name. And in the work of their hands, in the work of their hands, Lord, I pray, exalt them, bless them, prosper them, and make them a blessing in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answered prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. Remain blessed in Jesus' name.